Get ready to enter the Thrivetime Show.
We started from the bottom, now we're here. We started from the bottom, and we'll show you how to get here. We started from the bottom, now we're here. We started from the bottom, now we're here.
From the bottom, now we're on the top, teaching you the systems to get what we got. Colin Dixon's on the hooks, I break down the books. Z's bringing some wisdom and the good looks. As the father of five, that's why I'm a dive. So if you see my wife and kids, please tell them hi. It's the CNC up on your radio. And now 3, 2, 1, here we go.
We started from the bottom, now we
Boom, boom, and boom. Welcome back to the Thrivetime Show on your radio. My name is Clay Clark. I'm the former US SBA Entrepreneur of the Year, sent here to help you get your business in gear. I think a lot of people believe that your time to succeed is far, but it is actually very near. In fact, when you team up with a mentor who knows the way, someone that can show you specifically what you need to do to grow a successful business, great things can happen real fast. And I'll give you a quick example there, Thrivers. Years ago, I could not figure out how to retain great people and fire idiots. I just couldn't figure it out. I knew there was people that were idiots. I wanted to retain the good people. I wanted to fire the idiots. And so I set up a breakfast meeting with Mr. Chet Cadjo there, who at the time was the head of Quick Trip. And, Quick Trip, the gas stations, the convenience stores. And he directed me towards a book called The Service Profit Chain. And so I read The Service Profit Chain, and I implemented all of the action items that were in that book, and it absolutely changed the way that I did business. It was a game changer, and it really took DJ Connection to the next level and made it repeatable, it made it scalable, and it gave me the time freedom and financial freedom I needed because I was at a point where all the other aspects of the business were doing very, very well, but that was the one area I struggled with, was how do I fire idiots and keep great people? How do I reward the great people and penalize the people who are the bottom feeders? And so I think if you're listening today and you have a viable business that is actually selling a product or service that's real, that people actually perceive to be of value because it really does solve the problem that they have or provide a solution, then things are going well for you because you are going to learn some things today that can absolutely take your career to the next level. But what happens is if you reach out to a business coach or you've heard this radio show enough, you may start to wonder, well, what is a business coach and what does that business coaching experience look like? And so today I wanted to bring on a person that I've known here for the past 18 years. Unbelievable. Shrita, I've known you for 18 years.
I know, right?
When I first met you, are you 1 year older than my wife or the same age?
I'm not going to say. Do I have to answer
that? You're 1 year younger than my wife. That's great.
Years younger than both of you. That's what I'm going to say.
Okay. But you were on the same cheerleading squad as my wife. I believe my wife was like a freshman cheerleader, and I think you were like a sophomore.
Possibly.
But I think you were younger. But I was younger, but I was older.
Yeah.
You're like 12 on the team.
Yeah.
But anyway, so I met you back then, and you've kind of seen the maturation. You've seen the process. You've seen the growth in the different businesses. And so I'm going to allow you today to ask any of those rude questions that the Thrivers out there might want to know about business coaching, the onboarding process. And so, Shrita, we'll go ahead and get into your stack of stuff.
Okay, awesome. Well, I was thinking today about all the business experience that you have and all of the coaching and mentoring that you've done. And I did some calculations, and these are really conservative, but based off of like a 65, 70 hour work week, which I know is conservative because I know you work way more than that, but you have about 36,000 hours of coaching experience. isn't that amazing?
That's really amazing.
And again, like, that's conservative. I think that number is way higher.
Now, let me clarify for the Thrivers out there. Yeah. One is I do it because I choose to. I really like it.
Yeah.
I like it a lot. And I don't know if you're listening out there and you go, this is something I really enjoy. If you can think of something out there you really love, as an example, I have a very good friend of mine. I don't understand it, but he loves the game of golf.
Yeah.
He wants to somehow get the ball in the hole with as few of strokes as possible. Shrita, has that ever been a goal in your life?
It is not. I don't understand golf either.
But he will go out there with he and a ball, and they'll do an honor system. So it's he and a dude and a ball. and they'll whack their balls. There's two guys and there's two balls, two of these white golf balls. They'll smash the ball, and then what they'll do is they'll run around with a little pencil and a scorecard, and they'll write their own number down.
Yep.
And then they somehow meet up. I don't know if they meet for lunch or they meet up at each hole, but then they go, well, how many strokes did that take you to head it in? Well, I know if it was me, I'd be like, two.
Yeah.
What? No, you didn't do it in two. Yeah. Okay, well, three probably. You know, I mean, I would want to, like, you know, find a way to game the system or find a way to get there faster. But these guys are running around with the honor system trying to beat themselves in a game. Or they'll even golf by themselves. They'll go out there and golf for hours trying to get better. They're subscribing to Golf Digest.
Wow.
They're getting one-on-one lessons. And I'm going, are you competing for a tournament?
Yeah.
Can you make money? Are you trying out for a college team? I know you're 42, but are you trying out for a college team? And they say, no, I just love it. And that's the way I am with business coaching. For whatever reason, I just really enjoy helping people succeed and to grow their own businesses.
Yeah, that's really true. And it's been great to work with you and Vanessa over these years and see you in your element, because your eyes light up. You create with Z all these custom plans for businesses. And so my first question for you today is this. If there is someone who's listening and they're thinking, maybe I need a business coach, and they want to know, what happens if I decide to become a client? You know, we call it onboarding is what we call it when we bring on a new coaching client. What does that look like when someone meets with a coach for the first time? What does that look like? What do we do?
Well, the first thing I would put into your mind is that we're trying to establish a win-win. Okay, so the win-win that we have is we want you to be financially prosperous and to earn time freedom and financial freedom as a result of executing a proven plan. So I'll give an example. Today, I just got off the phone with Dr. Z. And he actually is traveling all around this great country right now, doing a lot of things, expanding his entrepreneurial empire. So he sends his hellos to you. But we have a top performer in one of the businesses, and he says, and there's no nothing I'm doing to provoke it. I'm not asking him. I'm not imploring. I'm just going over some updates with the businesses. And he says, we should buy that person a new car.
Yeah, that's awesome.
And I go, what? You should what? We should buy him a new car. And then he explains to me, he also wants to, because we were hitting some goals in some of the businesses, he's explained to me, Sharita, he wants to plant the biggest tree possible, the biggest tree you could possibly transplant in my lawn with me as a way to have sort of a man activity together.
I love it.
And I'm going, what? And he just never ceases to amaze me, his heart, his desire to give back.
Yeah.
But he's also, you work hard.
Yeah, definitely. But he's a giver.
He's a giver. Mm-hmm. But you work hard, you play hard. He didn't want to play hard with you if you're not going to work hard.
Yeah.
And so this is what we do when we do our initial evaluation. So if you want to become a business coaching client, if you want that to happen, step one, you don't pass the step, is we do a 13-point evaluation. And we do that 13-point evaluation. The point is to find out whether you would be a good fit for our program and we would be a good fit for you. Because Dale Carnegie, the best-selling author, and I'm paraphrasing here. I'm sorry I don't have it memorized there, Thrivers, but I want to read this to you. Just kind of, this is from my cranium. Just, I apologize if I'm getting off by a little bit here. But Dale Carnegie says, when dealing with people, remember you are not dealing with creatures of logic, but rather with creatures bristling with a prejudice and motivated by pride and vanity. So when you're talking to somebody who wants to grow their business, I can't tell you how many people reach out and want to learn about business coaching and having us grow their business because their friend, it's like their friend is doing very well as a result of our coaching program, and they'll reach out to us, and we realize, you're probably not going to be a good fit.
Mm.
And we find out that they're just not the kind of person who wants to keep a weekly appointment.
Yeah.
We meet with every client weekly. They're not the kind of person that wants to commit to doing their action items. You have to do some things. You don't just come to a coaching session and leave with our team having a bunch to do for you. So yes, as business coaches, we show you the strategy. Yes, as the world's only business coaching system that does this, we actually do your graphic design, your photography, your web development, your search engine, your online marketing with you. But you have to do something, right? Because Proverbs 10:4 says that God blesses the hand of the diligent, punishes the slacker. This is not a show. This is not a program. This is not a thing where you actually sit down and go, all right, I've paid my $114. Now you guys put on a show.
Yeah.
You guys just do it. So well, the first step is we do an evaluation with you. We go over your goals and we go over your strengths, your weaknesses, your biggest, you know, your competitors, who you're out there competing with, your biggest threats. We want to determine your biggest limiting factors so we can help you unlock your financial success there, Ms. Sherita.
Yes, that is great. And I love how you were talking about, you know, the design. We have a great team, I know, behind us that helps make all of these things come true. But I love that you said you have to be willing to do the work. So my next question is this. Who is a good fit for our program? Like, who are the people that we're saying, this may not work? Can you kind of break that down a little bit and tell us
more? Well, for some of our loyal listeners to the show, no, I am obsessed with one of our clients right now because they're really just hardworking people. And it's the good folks at the Tip Top Canine.
Yes.
And Tip Top Canine, you know, they came out to us like many other entrepreneurs saying, hey, listen, we have a good product, we believe, a good service. In their case, they teach people's dogs to behave. They'll teach your dog to sit. I mean, so many people have a dog, right? And you began to alter your life interaction with other people as a result of this crazy dog. You bought this cute little puppy, and now this dog jumps up on people. He's drooling on people. He's eating people's shoes. Yeah. He's humping your leg.
I hate that when they hump people. I hate that.
Oh,
I
you
hate
know
it.
What? I like humper. And so what happens is your dog's just out there showing its passion for other people's legs. It's not a move. And so what happens is you begin to become like almost a reclusive. Like people are like, what? Why don't you ever go outside? Do you need to take some vitamins? I mean, you're not getting any natural sunlight. What's going on? And you just begin to say, well, I have this dog. And I get it. I get it. I have a crazy dog, too. Well, Tip Top Canine, their passion is teaching people to they train the dogs in a way where you as the owner can have a dog that behaves well. Okay. Yeah. And so what they do is they have this great service. And what they needed to do was to market the service. They needed to find a way to make the service to create sales. They needed a way to convert those sales into ongoing relationships. They needed to teach other people to train the dogs beyond themselves. They needed to optimize their website. They needed a PR kit. They need a proforma. They need financial guidance. They need wisdom with leadership. They need to learn how to manage their company. They need to learn how to launch effective advertisements. They need to learn what to say no to. They need to learn how to manage their time. They need to learn how, and then they've looked at the fruit of our lives. They've looked at Dr. Z. They've seen the Z66 auto auction. They've seen Dr. Robert Zeldin and Associates. They've seen the Elephant in the Room Men's Grooming Lounge. They've seen Epic Photography. They've seen DJ Connection. They've seen the fruit of our lives, and they've realized, you know what? Whatever you guys are doing, I want to implement that proven path. So I want to do that, and I recognize that you guys are business coaches, not because you're wanting to run around selling charlatan dreams, but because you guys have actually done it. They see Z pull up in the Porsche. They've been to his house. They've seen him get on the jet and go on the vacation. They understand that he's a real deal entrepreneur, and he's not out there bragging about it, right? And so they realize that, you know what, we're going to go ahead and implement the system. If Z says to do something, we're going to go ahead and implement it. And so those are the kind of people we want to work with, because those are what I would call diligent doers. Now, happy hopers are people that are hoping that you'll give them some sort of magic secret that will unlock their financial freedom. These are people that are looking for a multi-level marketing campaign that's on the verge of exploding, at the ground level of exploding. And so we come back, Thrivers. We're going to teach you what the specific actionable business coaching experience looks like. Stay tuned. ThriveTimeShow.com.
If I got 3 strikes, I'ma go for it. This moment, we own it. I'm not to be played with, because it could get dangerous.
Oh, and it could get dangerous. You go out there and you do something crazy like start your own business. Let me tell you how crazy it can be. As the former U.S. SBA Entrepreneur of the Year and the co-host of this of the Thrivetime Show, I have been through almost every crazy business scenario you could possibly think of. Dr. Zellner has been through almost every scenario as well. You talk about hiring people, firing people in office, drama. You talk about employees that get other employees' wives pregnant. What? You talk about employees who are getting other employees' wives pregnant. You talk about inner office affairs. You talk about people stealing money. You talk about people breaking in, stealing your stuff. You talk about scams. You talk about people stealing your clients. You want to talk about drama? No, you don't. But that's the real stuff. I mean, that's the stuff behind the stuff. And I don't care if you're struggling with search engine, you're struggling with marketing, you're struggling with hiring, firing, legal issues, tax problems. We know the way. We've gone the way. We're here to help you. And this show is all about business coaching. And so Sherita has started some tasks. Sherita Bent, one of our business coaches, she goes, you know, for me, a lot of this stuff now is, you know, she's seen it. It's kind of becoming more and more common for her because she's in it every day. She sees landscapers and roofers and doctors and lawyers grow their businesses tremendously. And so she sees, though, that gap that I don't see sometimes because of the curse of knowledge. The curse of knowledge is where you know so much about a thing, you forget what you used to not know. And so, Sherita, any question that you want to ask about the business coaching process, you have the floor, my friend.
Yes. The next thing I wanted to ask you is sometimes we will hear, you know, people allude to their industry. And I know you just listed off, you know, a wide variety of clients that we have, and they're from every industry imaginable. But sometimes people entering the coaching program, we've heard entrepreneurs say this before and we have to address it. My industry is different. You know, I just wanted to ask you to speak to that, because there's some mindset where people think, oh, because it's this business, I don't need to do A, B, or C. But really, it's all the same. I've learned that from you and Z. And so would you just elaborate on that a bit?
Yeah, well, I'm going to just give you an example here. On page 13 of a book called The E-Myth, and Thrivers, just so you, or so I know some of you are getting scared as though, oh my gosh, he remembers all this? No, but I just I know where to find the information. I've been doing this forever. But on page 13 of the book called The E-Myth by Michael Gerber, I think any business coach respects what he wrote here in his best-selling book. He says, the fatal assumption is, if you understand the technical work of a business, you must understand a business that does not that does that technical work. Again, the fatal assumption is that if you understand the technical work of a business, you understand a business that does that technical work. What it's saying is you feel like that you understand a business. You understand how to make a cake. Let's example. Let's say you're very good at making cakes. So now you believe that you understand how to make a cake business. You're very good at welding. And so you feel like that you can build a welding business. And what happens is, rather than learning how to make the business work for you, you decide that you're going to do the work yourself. And then suddenly, you find yourself working at a job where you work all the time. I mean, you don't have any time freedom at all because you're the only one who knows how to do anything. And then what happens is that you get stuck in that rut of believing that you are self-righteous, you know it all, you are incredible at your making cakes, and therefore no one could possibly teach you how to make a cake making business because you know about fondant and buttercream but I want the Thrivers to get this. Dr. Z does not know very much information about an auto auction. I mean, in all due respect for my mentor and my friend, he's not a car guru, nor does he pretend to be. I would argue he's not really into optometry.
Yeah.
I don't know that he's excited about the human eyeball. I don't know that he obsesses about your iris. I don't know if he's like, oh, Sherita, please let me touch your retina. Please let me touch your retina. I want to see, let me see the retina. Yeah. I want to see the retina down. I love the iris. Can I just see your iris? Let me touch your pupil. Yeah. No, he's not doing that. He's not obsessed with banking.
I'm
so excited about the monetary system. Please let me talk to you about the fiat currency. Yeah. I want to talk to you about the fiat currency. I want to talk to you about the money. I know how it's printed. I know how to. No, but he's not doing that. What he's doing is he is obsessed with building a business because the business is designed to serve him. He's going to build a business that's going to serve him, and he's just going to find a need that the market has, and he's going to fill it. And then he'll hire somebody who's a technician to do the thing. He'll hire an optometrist to see the patients, but he's going to build the optometry business. He'll hire a mechanic to maintain the vehicles, but he's going to own the auction. So the question is today, do you want to own the business or do you want the business to own you? And if you cannot accept that every business is more similar than it is different. It's, every business is about 90% the same and 10% different. If you can't accept that, then your business will always own you. You'll never own your business. You don't have a business. You have a job. And a job means just over broke. You work all the time. And whenever you take a day off, the revenue stops. And Sharita, that's what we want to get the Thrivers out of that yes. cycle. That cycle of suck. Unless you are selling vacuums, copious amounts of vacuums, your business cannot suck. Sharita.
That is good. That's
bam.
Great. So when you are working with clients, when our coaching team, our business coaches, when we're working with clients and we are teaching them these systems, these processes, helping them develop these checklists, all of this information that, you know, you and Z have like honed down to this, you know, just impeccable system. How do we hold, you know, our clients accountable? Because sometimes the things that we're working on, they're not fun sometimes, right? Sometimes you're having to work on checklists and work on processes. How do you hold people accountable? How do we do that? Because we don't want them to drift and we want them to get those results.
Well, it starts with you keeping commitments to yourself. Now, this is a profound concept I want you to think about. There's a word called dissonance out there. If you're somebody who's into psychology and you like to read about these kind of things, dissonance is this phenomenon where there's a lack of harmony between musical notes. There's a tension or a clash resulting from these disharmonious, unsuitable elements. As an example, you maybe say to your friends and family that you believe in showing up early. You say, I believe in showing up early. I love to be early. I'm very prompt. But yet everybody who knows you knows you're always late. That was me in high school. All right. So I was me early college.
I love that the person doesn't know that they're always late.
No. You know how it is, though. You know, and it's just a deal where like you. So what you do is you make these commitments to yourself, but you dishonor your own commitments. You lie to yourself, which causes a feeling of dissonance. Mm. Now, if you make a commitment to yourself and you actually honor that commitment, then the result, the reward you get is confidence. And once you get that confidence, you're able to then lead a team. So I'm hoping that you're not at the basic level where you're struggling with making commitments to yourself. But if you are, we can help you. Mm. But then once, if you're not, we can help you as well. But if you are there, we need to teach you how to build key performance indicators to hold your team accountable. When we come back, we're going to talk all about how to manage a large group of humans. It's the Thrivetime Show on your radio. It's America's number one business coaching show. My name is Clay Clark. Check out ThriveTimeShow.com to get your tickets to our next in-person workshop and watch Back to the Future over and over until your brain explodes. It's a great movie.
Started from the bottom, now we're here. Started from the bottom, now we're here.
I don't know why I would have said that, but I'll tell you why I said that. Because I went to Oral Roberts University. I did make a mixtape in my dorm room. And what happened was is somebody put it on the student voicemail system. Mm. Now, they did not ask me, Mrs. Sharita Bent. They did not ask me.
I remember.
So people didn't ask me, hey, could I put the song on the student voicemail system and broadcast it out to all the students? They did not ask that question. But what they did is they said, could I borrow the CD? This is back in the day with the CD, back in the day with the Napster where you could download songs illegally, whatever. So I said, sure. Next thing you know, I wake up and at Oral Roberts University in Tulsa, Oklahoma, the song is pulsing on every single, it shows a flashing red light. And it says, you have a message from Dean Boyd's office.
Oh.
And it is the song, the ORU Slim Shady, which you can now find on YouTube, the ORU Slim Shady. And that's what that song got me kicked out of Oral Roberts University. And basically, the school's president did not like me making comments about him very much. He didn't appreciate the song's artistic values
yes.
as much as I did. And Adam Bagwell, the co-creator of the song. And so, but years later.
Here's what was great about it, though. They didn't just share it one time. I loved that they kept sharing it multiple times. Like, you'd go to class, then you'd come back that night. Blinking red light again. It's the song. That was my favorite part, is that it just kept getting, it was like the gift that kept on giving.
And what happened was, is that I was made to feel bad. They wanted me to apologize. And I'm like, you know, I'm not going to apologize. They wanted me to apologize to the student body and try to make
it
right.
We liked it. We all liked it. It was a great song.
And so what happened was, is that I decided, you know what, I'm not going to apologize. So I got asked to leave. But then in November 23rd of 2007, when I was feeling it, like I was at the apex of awesome. I just received the Entrepreneur of the Year from the Small Business Administration. I was just now getting into the business coaching world. People were asking me to help them grow their companies. This is 2007. On November 23rd, Oral Roberts University, CNN did a story. You know, they came out and it said that Oral Roberts University president quits amid a lawsuit. And when I read the PDF of what the allegations were, I was like, yes, yes, yeah. It did happen.
Yeah.
He's gone. And then when I read about how people were misusing student funds and various things, I was like, yes. And then when I read about, I read the stories, and I'm going, yes, yes, that is what I'm talking about. Yes. And people were like, do you feel bad? What are your thoughts? Because we went to ORU, so everyone's asking, you know. What do you think about what's going on? Do you feel bad? How does it make you feel? You know, because it was a national headline story for about a week there.
Yeah.
And I'm going, I love this.
Yeah.
This is great. And so I just snuck in that little reference.
Yeah,
there,
you're like, I wrote a prophetic song about this many years ago.
Prophetic song. Yeah. Okay, so we're talking about business coaching, how to grow your business. Sharita, what questions do you have on behalf of the Thrive Nation out there, these business owners who maybe want to know a little bit more about the business coaching experience?
Okay, so here's one that I get a lot. Maybe this is a person who is not knowing whether they need business coaching or not. If I'm an entrepreneur, what would be some clues or some little keys or situations that I might be dealing with to let me know it might be time for me to get some business coaching?
If you're somebody who believes that that anything is unproductive unless it's thinking about the work that you need to do right now, if you're somebody who believes that anything that you're doing right now, if it's not related to immediately what needs to be done right now, then you are what I would call a technician. And the technician really isn't interested in a strategic plan to get things done. They're interested in just doing the thing. So here's an example. Years ago, there was a business I worked with down in the Dallas area. And this person had won a lot of awards for the best cakes in the area. You know, all the awards you can win, the Martha Stewart Weddings Awards, the Wedding Wire Awards, all these awards for the best wedding cakes. You know, all those bridal magazines, Sharita. You can get those at Target,
yes,
you know.
Yes, yes.
And so this person was obsessed with cakes. And my wife and I were helping her. My wife and I worked together in everything, you know. And Vanessa goes in there. It's kind of like Chip and Joanna, except I'm uglier than Chip, and she's more beautiful than Joanna. But anyway, so it's basically like, you know, there's Beauty and the Beast. There's like Beauty and Jabba the Hutt. That's what our story is. She's Beauty. I'm the Hutt.
BJ.
So anyway, so I go in there, and I'm just going, you know, very Jabba the Hutt-ish. Are you always afraid I'm going to eat the person next to me? Whatever. So we go in there, and Vanessa's doing the math, and she discovers that this person, if the math is correct, is spending approximately, and I'm not exaggerating, about $30, if I remember right, $30 to $35 per egg.
Per egg?
Yeah. So Vanessa's like,
I thought you were going to say per cake.
No, per egg.
Oh, my God.
Because this person was charging people almost $1,200 for a wedding cake, and there was no profit left.
Oh.
And so Vanessa's pointing out, like, hey, we need to make a pro forma. So she dials in all the costs. You make all your hard costs. That's all your fixed costs, all your expenses on the left column. Thomas Edison, by the way, is the one teaching us this. The guy who started, you know, GE, invented the light bulb, the video, recorded sound. It's called a one sheet of your pro forma. But long story short, you get all your expenses on one sheet, and you get all your variable expenses. So one is your fixed, like your real estate, all your expenses that don't change. You know, your utilities, your real estate, your insurance, whatever. The ones that are pretty static, pretty much the same. Then on the other column, you make the costs that go into making every cake. She does the math, and she realizes at this current rate, you're going to lose about $7 to $8 per cake. So the more cakes you make, you're going to lose money. So you're either overpaying labor, who's lying to you about how much time it takes to make something,
mm-hmm.
or someone's taking advantage of your credit card at the store. Something weird is going on. So this person refused to emotionally participate in the process of actually analyzing their business because all they wanted to do was make cakes. Almost like they're mildly, like almost autistic, you know, where they're, I just want to make cakes. That's all I want to do is make cakes because cake making is all I do. And that's all I want to do. And I love to make cakes because that's all I do. And you're going, that's okay. But we need to measure how long it takes for someone to do the crumb coating. Well, I put a stopwatch on it and someone could crumb coat a cake in about 7 to 10 minutes, right? I mean, it was less than 10 minutes. So I'm going, there's no way you should be paying this much for someone to crumb coat a cake. Someone should be able to crumb coat all of your cakes in one day. And crumb coating, by the way, is like putting a wireframe mesh around your cake so that the concrete, or in this case, the fondant icing, can stick to it so that it can adhere to the sides of the cake. The person was totally disinterested in learning these systems, but that's what makes a profit. And they would rather spend their day making cupcakes. Now, the cupcakes they were selling for $2 a cupcake were costing them almost $1.60 per cupcake. So Vanessa points out the math and says, hey, listen, if you could sell like 4,000 cupcakes per week, and you can't because of your capacity of your ovens, you would barely break, you would barely be able to feed your family. Mm. So you need to quit making cupcakes. We need to focus on measuring the unit economics of making the cakes. And this person completely refused to engage in that conversation because they were obsessed with doing the actual work of making the cake. So if you're somebody, and that sounds like you, you definitely need a business coach, because you have to really be able to, if you realize that as you observe yourself throughout the day, and you realize that, you know what, my business is not growing unless I personally do the work. If your business is only growing as a result of what you can personally do, then you definitely need a business coach. Now, what a business coach does is they don't sit together with you and talk about how you feel. A business coach shows you the proven best practices and systems you need to make your business grow. When we come back, we'll show you how we do it. I'll show you. Welcome back to the Thrivetime Show on your radio. Justin Bieber fans, welcome back to the Thrivetime Show on your radio. We have so many. Shreda, I was thinking about this the other day. I was looking at our statistics of where Thrivers are coming from.
Yeah.
And don't get me wrong, I love Oklahomies. Let me tell you, I love some Oklahoma Joes.
Yeah. Oh.
I love some of those baked beans. Mm. I love some of those burnt ends.
Yes.
I love the values. I love our culture. But at the last workshop, we had many, many more people from all around the world than we had from Tulsa. And I think it's because universally, as Americans, and Shreda, I don't know if you can relate to this. I've never really asked you this, but you tell me. I want to know here.
Yeah.
If you had all the money that you could possibly have, I mean, you just had it all.
Yeah.
What would you spend your time doing? I mean, what would you, I mean, it seems like this is a universal quest people have, is to hurry up and achieve financial freedom so they can pursue, you know, the other things. Yeah. What are the things that you would do? What are your goals? If you had all the money, all the time in the world, what would you be doing?
I would definitely travel nonstop. I would travel all the time.
Really?
Yes. And
where?
I would go all over the world. I'd start overseas, over like in Europe, and I'd tour Europe. Then I'd go, you know, to Africa.
You'd go to Europe?
I would go there in a
heartbeat. Get specific. What would you, I mean, I don't understand. Are you a big Brexit fan? Do you love Brexit? Are you obsessed with Ireland's low taxes? I mean, what are the things that you're, what would make you want to go to Europe? Are you, you want to go to Rome? Where you want to go?
I would touch every country if I could, every country. I would go everywhere because I love history. I love seeing new places. I love learning about, you know, what happened here in this place and this culture. But I would also, in addition to my travels, I would be singing as I traveled, because that would be like my two loves, like travel and singing. So I'd tour their little, you know, clubs and sing and see the world. That's what I would do. What would you do?
This show.
Oh, see,
that's
you're in your zone.
I'm just saying, this is what I like to do. It's my flow.
This is what I do.
I went on a trip here. I'm sorry. I'm not a good human. But I went to a trip, and I go on these trips because, one, I love my wife. She just had her birthday. She's a great American. She turned like 21
Vanessa.
Again. Unbelievable.
Happy birthday.
So we went out there to Florida, you know, for a trip.
Yeah.
And I have to mentally slow down, because I'm so used to being super productive, getting stuff done, and I like it.
Yeah.
That I'm at the trip. I don't have a radio show to produce. I don't have meetings to be in. I have no key performance indicators to measure.
Yeah.
But I know how to do that. So I'm like wanting to become the most efficient dad possible. So I'm like, well, at 10:25, we're gonna go to we're gonna go here over to they don't have Sprouts over there. They have this place called Publix.
Yes.
So I'm gonna go to Publix at 10:52. At 11, I'll drop you guys off at 10:52. At 11 o'clock, I'll come back. When I come back, I'll have the lotion from Walgreens. Then what I'll do is we'll go to this. There's this, a beach I've read about, and at 11:30 exactly they open up. Well, then you get in the car with the five kids.
Yeah.
And we drop off the family at 10:52, and somehow like at 12:52, we're still there. And I'm going, how is this possible? Well, then we go on a wave runner kind of thing, and the guy comes out, kind of a pirate theme kind of guy, and he's, are you ready to ride the wave runner? And I'm looking at the guy, and I'm going, you know, typically, because in the business, I'm really good at interviewing people and kind of knowing where they're at. You know, there's just certain people that you don't want to bring into your organization, you don't want to hire. Certain people you do. Typically, by the way, Thrivers, if you look somebody in the eye, and that you ask them a direct question, and they look up and to the right, you know, into the right, and they look up to the left. Typically, they're trying to think of what to say, or they're typically, and if they've got a shifty eyes, or they talk very, very fast with excessive details, you typically know they're lying, you know? So I'm like, you know, just my wife's out there, voof, voof, you know, she's wave running around, you know, and then the guy says, make sure you don't take this baby over 65, you know, 65. Well, my son, you know, he's out there with my wife on the wave runner, voof, voof, out there on the ocean in the Tampa the bay area out there on the ocean. And I talked to the guy and I said, so man, how often do you maintain these? And he's like, well, what we do is we maintain these constantly. I mean, it's like every, like, you know. And I'm hearing him, I'm going, oh my gosh, he's never maintained this vehicle. Baby, come back. I'm just like wanting to wave at her. Yeah. She comes back. My son says, Dad, Mom went 70. And I'm like, 70? Because when you fall off a wave runner going 70 miles an hour, it's like hitting concrete.
Yeah.
My whole frame is being broken. My whole worldview. I'm just like, no, safety first. Yeah. Now we're safety second. I got a pirate who doesn't maintain the wave runner doing it. We're taking 2 hours to go to Publix. This is not efficiency, people. But what I do is I get calm, and about day two, yeah, I'm able to enjoy the vacation. And I'm not kidding. I start mentally counting down how many hours are left.
Till
I can get back into my flow.
Yeah.
And so Thrive Nation, what we want to do is, whether your flow is doing a radio show and coaching businesses, or your flow is traveling Europe, I'm not here to judge and say what your flow should be. But we want to help you as business coaches to achieve your financial and time freedom goals right away, so you can spend your time doing whatever you want to do. So first off, you need to write out your F6 goals. Your goals for your faith, your goals for your family, your goals for your finances, your goals for your friendships, fitness, and fun. And
if you make it, why do I have to write it down? This is another thing. Why do I have to write those things down? Can I just know them in my head?
There's a lot of offensive verses out there in the Bible, you know, called it. There's like the Ten Commandments, and there's, you know, the idea was in the Bible. And I hate to be the one who quotes the Bible all the time, but, you know, like Exodus 20 as an example, you know. Apparently God spoke these words. I know a lot of people get really all worked up when you say that God said something, but this is what it says in Exodus 20. It says, and God spoke all of these words. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven or above, or the sun, or on the earth beneath, or in the waters below. You shall not bow down. And he just goes on and on. God's explaining these things. And they're going, God, can we get something to write this down with? And so what happens is eventually, you know, Moses and God, they connect the whole story. I'm not exactly sure of the timeline, but long story short, they write these things called the Ten Commandments.
Mm-hmm. I liked God's voice, by the way.
Oh, yeah. I've been working on that a lot. Sometimes in the office, people don't respect. Sometimes I'll make an announcement like, we have a four-door car where the lights are on, and then we have the mic, you know? And a lot of people are like, yeah, whatever. It's probably just whatever. But then if I say, attention, everybody. This is the voice of God. We have a four-door vehicle, and the lights are on. Everyone's like, oh, my gosh, I think I heard from the voice of God himself. Like, just kidding, people. It wasn't actually God. I don't want to be sacrilegious, but seriously, I'm working on this voice. So the thing is that you eventually have to write down things on the tablet, because today, I mean, if you go to many places of business, many places of government, many houses of worship, if you open the Bible, those Ten Commandments, Sharita, they stay true today. They've carried on that thought for that amount of time. And in this digital smog, this digital clutter where the smartphone's making us all dumb, according to the Psychology Today article, if you don't write it down, you're going to drift, you're going to forget what your dreams are, and you're going to end up living in a van down by the river, Shark.
The van down by the river.
That's how it happens.
It's true.
Okay, so Thrive Nation, here's the deal. You've got to first off know where you want to be. And now, Sharita, what are some business coaching questions you have for the Thrivers out there who say, I know where I want to be. I finally do know where I want to be. What is a question that you feel like a lot of Thrivers may have about the business coaching experience?
Yeah, I think another question that's really good, and we talk about this a lot on our team and with you and Z kind of mentoring us. What is the difference between working in your business and on your business? Because trying to explain that to people when we're coaching and what that looks like, I think they're so used to working in the business. But break that down. What's the difference?
Well, as a technician, as somebody who does the work, you know, as an entrepreneur, if you're somebody who, I'm just going back to the example of being a welder. Mm-hmm. You're so used to paying your dues. I mean, you've devoted so many hours to the business during the startup phase that you feel like, listen, if something needs to be done, I'm going to get it done. I mean, you're to the point where you're just... You work so much that you feel like that's just the normal. You are a master juggler at this point. I mean, you're putting in 14-hour days, and you absolutely are just, you're working all the time to fulfill the orders for mm-hmm. the welding jobs that are coming in. But if you are to a place now where you say, listen, I want to exchange not my time for money anymore. I want to exchange my systems for my time. I want to exchange money for my time. You want to build a business that can serve you. You want a business that can produce so much money that you're able to say, you know what? I don't want to mow my own lawn. I'm going to have someone else mow my lawn. I don't want to do my own dry cleaning. I want to hire somebody else. If you find your place if you find yourself in a place where you're reaching out for kind of a business Yoda, if you will, if you find yourself needing a business coach, and you need somebody who knows the way. I mean, Luke had to go out to Dagobah. Remember that he had to fly out?
I do.
He flies out. You know, he lands that X-Wing, crashes that thing in the mud. He gets there, he finds this guy, and he says, Yoda, you seek Yoda. Just take me to Yoda. Where is he? In due time. Take you to him, I will. Yoda. You know, and he just will not tell him where Yoda is. In due time, take you to him, I will. First we eat must. The thing is, if you're tired of somebody not giving you the answers and you just want to meet Yoda himself, you can do it. We can teach you how to do it. We have your business Yodas available for you right here at ThriveTimeShow.com. Check it out. Learn more. We'll be back after the break.
For sure, I'll show you.
All right, welcome back into your audio dojo of mojo. It is the Thrive Time Show on your radio. My name is Clay Clark. I'm the former SBA Entrepreneur of the Year. I'm the father of five human kids. Father of five human kids? What happened? Well, I'll tell you what happened. There was some horizontal activity that happened repeatedly. I had some time freedom. I invested that time freedom, if you will. And what I did is we created some human kids. We have matriculated. We have coached these kids. They are now people that can shake your hand, look you in the eye, capable of showing up on time. They're almost to the age where they can be accountable, right? Because they're accountable for their actions. They're kids that they do things and they get a consequence, good or bad, a consequence, good or bad, as a result of their actions. And what happens is, for a lot of people, we get out into that world, man. We get out into that world where we went to high school. And Sharita, do you remember it in high school and in college, and they gave you fall break?
I do.
And so we're going to college at Oral Roberts University, right? And it's around the fall time, hence fall break. Yeah. And all of a sudden, you're looking at that calendar going, man, I got 2 weeks available. I have 2 weeks available. I'm a freshman. I'm a sophomore. The rest of the world's out there working, unaware that fall break is a thing.
Yeah.
But you call up your mom. You call up. Frida, where would you go on fall break? Would you stay on campus, or did you typically go back to Tennessee? Where did you go for fall break?
I think I typically stayed because I had to work several jobs, you know, and so I stayed and worked usually.
Wait a minute. So life got real for you. You were working pretty early?
Yeah. Yeah. I've had to work my whole life since I was little.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I was working too, right?
Yeah.
So I'm working. So I remember it's like a ghost town at Oral Roberts University.
No one was there. Yeah.
A lot of these people, their parents are paying for their school.
They're on trips. They're like, you know, going wherever.
Now I'll tell you how you know back in the day, how you knew back in the day if you were somebody who was a diligent doer because you had to, Or if because, or if you were at college and you were kind of just enjoying the free ride, you know, I'll tell you how you knew. One is that at Oral Roberts University and other colleges, I went to St. Cloud State for a while and OSU, they give you a meal plan treated.
Yeah.
Now, typically, in a standard week, there's 7 days. I mean, would you agree with me this thus far?
Totally agree.
You got a 7 day week, and they typically will say you get 3 meals a day. You know, you get breakfast, you get that lunch, you get that dinner. And I remember when you could check the box. You know, do you want 21 meals? Do you want? And I remember I want 10 meals.
Yeah.
You want 10 meals or 7 days? Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah.
And I've got a whole like bagel hustle going on. I remember telling my buddy, "Here's the deal: you bring me a bagel.
Yeah.
I'll hook you up with 50 cents.
Oh my gosh.
A dollar.
Yeah.
Cool. Dollar. Bagel. I lived off of straight bagels.
Yeah.
But that was the move because I had to. Life got real early for me.
Me too.
Now, for some of you listening right now, life is just now getting real. It was easy for you when you were single. You're out there, you know, working at your job. You know, all the money that comes in, you spend that. You get that DirecTV going on. You got that car payment going. You drive around that Honda. You may be upgraded with that leather Honda. You've got the CD player, but you've also got that Sirius satellite, whatever going on. You got that DirecTV, that NFL package. And all of a sudden, you got married. Now you have a kid. And all of a sudden, you go, uh-oh. Life just got real. Some of you just got that health care bill, and you said, uh-oh. Mm. Some of you just had a kid going to private school. Mm. Some of you have an illness where now you're the sole provider. Some of you, I mean, there's life just got real for somebody. And that's where... I highly recommend that you would hire a business coach, whether it be our program or the eMyth program or the Traction program. Our program is designed to be the most affordable, but regardless of what program you choose, I highly recommend if life just got real and you realize you don't, you get to the end of the month and you realize you ran out of money. You run out of money. You get to the end of your money before the end of the month. If that's you, then you, my friend, if you're a business owner, you need a business coach. But when you reach out to a business coach, Sherita, there's a lot of people that have questions about, you know, what does a business coach do? What does that look like? And you are around these people. You're around these business owners every day, and you see their perspective.
Yeah.
So what questions do you have for me about the business coaching experience on behalf of those thrivers out there?
Yeah, here's a great one. How much time does it take to go through this business coaching system or process? That's one that comes up. How much time is it going to take?
Okay. Well, first off, if you want to work in a business, if you don't want to work on a business, you don't want to invest the time to think strategically, then you need to just go get a job for someone else's business. But if you are wanting to create time freedom, then you need to work on your business. You need to work on your business if you want to create time freedom. And as far as time goes, it's kind of like a garden. I don't garden. Sherita, do you garden? Are you a gardener?
Occasionally, I do. Occasionally. I like it.
Have you ever raised a dog?
Yes, I have.
Okay, so it's kind of like, you know, how long do I have to feed this dog? You know what I mean? I got this dog. I named him. He's a puppy. Yeah. Now he's a big guy. How long do I need to feed him? Two more times?
Yeah.
You know, what you need to do is you need to feed the puppy. You need to feed the dog. You need to coach the dog.
Yeah.
You need to make sure you get the dogs the shots. Mm.
This reminds me of John Kelly because he has Chauncey right now.
He has Jonathan Kelly, one of our project managers up in the office.
Yeah.
He has a new bulldog, beautiful, beautiful dog. But when you have a business, and I'll just give you an example, Dr. Robert Zellner and Associates, they've been in business for 25 years in Tulsa. I mean, Tulsa, thank you so much for supporting his business. They've been in business for 25 years right there next to Woodland Hills Mall.
Mm-hmm.
And when they started out, there was this thing called the Yellow Pages. Hey, you remember the Yellow Pages?
I remember.
Man,
yes.
I remember. The
phone book was massive back then. It was huge.
Oh, and if you were an attorney, you knew you were on the front of that.
True.
You wanted to be on the front. Every attorney wanted to be that superstar on the front of that yellow book, that phone book, that yellow massive book. Basically, they mailed you a tree they'd cut into slices. You got your own tree. You didn't realize what was happening there.
It's true.
But to get that book to you, they went into the Amazon. A lot of people are worried about the Amazon. They're saying, you know, the Amazon, they're tearing down all the trees. What was happening is they were just mailing you a book.
Mm.
One book per tree. That's how that happened. So what happens is you get that big book, and you would look in it for the A listing. So if you're looking for plumbing, you know, you go to the P section for plumbing because you're a genius. You flip to it, you look, and there's A best plumbing, you know, because those guys are geniuses and they named their company an A, you know. Then there's A1 plumbing, which is ahead of A best because A1 is ahead of AB, alphabetically speaking. Well, then all of a sudden they changed the game and all of a sudden that wasn't a thing. And then you had to come up with search engine optimization. And then the jerks came up with the thing called the smartphone. I say the jerks. I mean, think about it. The Japanese, these non-Americans, they created the smartphone. Then the Americans realized, hey, brands like Nokia. Remember the Nokia? Shrita, do you remember the Nokia phone where you would get, and your phone would always have that weird ring? Do you remember that ring? What was it? What, do you remember how your ring was?
I remember. I had one of those. I can't remember.
It was always some like lame kind of Super Mario Brothers kind of sound. That was it.
Something like that.
Yeah, that was it. And your phone would ring, and you'd have like 300 minutes.
Yeah. Yes. Oh, goodness. I remember that.
And they were 300 outbound.
People don't know how good they have it now. Okay. Those minutes were stressful.
And it was in range.
Yeah.
So if you left Jinx and you were going to the non-covered area on the orange map that Singular AT&T Singular had, you would be roaming.
Yes.
And when you were roaming,
ridiculous,
like you were in Italy, when you were roaming, I mean, when you were out there roaming, you were getting those big charges. So what you would do is I would call you, Sharita. This is how I do it. I'd say, hey, is this Sharita?
Yes.
Hey, Sharita, this is Clay. How you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
Hey, anyway, I just wanted to talk to you about it. I have something really important I want to talk to you about. And then I just hang up. And then you call me back, right? Because you call me back because you're like, oh, my gosh, I lost you. And I go, I don't know what happened.
You always have the super moves.
But then what happened is you are now using your minutes. And now I'm able to do that move and talk.
I love it.
So the problem was when you had like a girlfriend or something, you want to get her on the landline.
Mm-hmm.
You want to call her on the landline. You say, hey, girl, what's that landline? Yeah. What's the number? What's the hard phone number? For people listening right now going, landline? No, it's LAN, L-A-N, landline. It's like a phone that was plugged in. Some of you listening right now have never even seen one of these things.
Yeah.
But what happened is that was the move. Now, technology keeps changing, and the smartphone came out. Now your website has to look good on a smartphone. Then you got to optimize it. Then there's Yelp. Then there's Facebook. Then there's YouTube ads. And then there's retargeting ads. And it just keeps getting crazier. And then tax law changes, right?
Yeah.
Tax law changes. The way you can invest changes. The way you can fire people. There's right to work now in Oklahoma. Minimum wage goes up, it goes down, things change. So what happens is you have got to have somebody who's holding you accountable and showing you the way. And I would advise that everybody listening right now that you would have a business coach. Now you might say, you know what, that is a very self-serving concept for you to say that because you are in fact a business coach. But I want to give you a quote here from Eric Schmidt, who actually was the former CEO of Google. And he had a quote that he said in Fortune magazine, if you want to look it up. You just go to archive.fortune.com. And he says this. He says, the best advice that sticks out I got was from John Doerr, who in 2001 said, my advice to you, this is the CEO of Google, is to have a coach. The business coach, he said, I should have is Bill Campbell. I initially resented the advice because after all, I was the CEO of Google. I was pretty experienced. Why should I need a business coach? Am I doing something wrong? My argument was, how could a business coach advise me if I'm the best person in the world at this? I mean, what? But that's not what a business coach does. The coach doesn't have to play the sport as well as you do. They have to watch you and get you to play at your best. In the business context, a business coach is not a repetitious coach. A business coach is somebody who looks at something with another set of eyes, describes it to you in words, and discusses how to approach the problem. Once I realized that I could trust him and that he could help me with perspective, I decided that this was a great idea. When there is a conflict, a business conflict, you tend to get rat-holed into it. Bill's general advice has been to rise one step higher above the person on the other side of the table and to take the long view. He'll say, you're letting it bother you. Mm. Don't. That's what a business coach can do, Sharita. And I think so many people, they just have never worked with one before.
Mm, that's a really good.
Now, Shark, I want to ask you this because you have, just today in the office, we worked with probably, I think together we worked with 10 business coaching clients, just you and me directly today.
Yeah.
I would love to have you ask any of, like if you're a fly on the wall and you could analyze some of the behavior that the clients did where you're like, man, that is a dysfunction.
Yeah.
But they won't know you're talking about them because you're not going to mention any details about them. We're talking very vague, specific, very vague areas, but specific, you know, specific issues, but very vague descriptive narratives. So we're not throwing anybody under the bus here.
Sure.
But I would love to get your perspective as sort of a business coach, fly on the wall. And if you could kind of tee up some of the dysfunctions that you saw where you go, man, this person could be so much more successful if they would just do this. But because you're not in the situation, because you're not in the forest, you can see the trees. And that's an unbelievable perspective that you get to have as a business coach day in, day out. And I just know that our listeners, many of them are so busy working so hard, getting up early, staying up late, growing that business, that you're unable to see some of the most glaring weaknesses that may be obvious to somebody else. And so I think, Sri, it'd be very, very helpful if you could break it down like fractions and show the thrivers, kind of illuminate to them some of those repetitive dysfunctions that you've seen time and time again. And before we go to break, I encourage everybody to go to ThriveTimeShow.com. That's ThriveTimeShow.com and get your tickets for our next in-person business workshop. Many have called it the world's best business workshop, but I'm trying to sell you something. I'm trying to convince you to get out to it. So just go to ThriveTimeShow.com, read those reviews, watch the video testimonials, book your tickets. If you feel like you can't afford it, you now can because we have a scholarship available. This is your year to thrive. This is your moment to succeed. You have what it takes. I know that you do. If your mind is mentally functional enough to find this radio show and to listen to it, you have what it takes to become a successful entrepreneur, but you have got to become a pursuer. You've got to become a doer. You've got to become somebody who doesn't just think about the idea, but somebody who actually takes that action.
I want to be on the cover of Forbes magazine, smiling next to Oprah and the Queen.
Oh, wow. What a great segue. I mean, speaking of Forbes, Thrive15.com, the world's most affordable business school, has been featured in Forbes. If you're just now tuning into the program, my name is Clay Clark. I'm the founder of Thrive15.com. I'm the former SBA Entrepreneur of the Year. I'm the co-founder of the Elephant in the Room Men's Grooming Lounge. I'm the founder of Epic Photography. I'm the founder of DJ Connection. I'm the founder of the Tulsa wedding, the big wedding show, the Bridal Association. I've started a lot of companies. And the reason that I'm on the show with you is because the great people at Scripps Radio realize that Tulsa and many other cities all out there around the world are largely ran by small business owners. You know, in fact, in Tulsa, the statistics are even more skewed toward small business owners. But according to Forbes, since 1995, Sharita, 65% of all of the jobs that have been created in this great country have been created by small business owners. And so typically, Dr. Robert Zellner and I get to talk about entrepreneurship and teach you how to start and grow a successful company, but he's out expanding his vast entrepreneurial empire now today. And so Miss Sharita Bent is joining us, one of our business coaches, and she gets to be in the meetings working with real small business owners. I'm not talking about the theory. I'm talking about the hard working men and women who are actually paying those taxes, who are actually working those 14-hour days. And Sharita, I asked you before the break if you could kind of share with us maybe some of the dysfunctions that you see, maybe some of the questions that you might have about why people do that. And you can kind of break it down because you have this unbelievable opportunity to literally have a meeting with a landscaper, then have one with an insurance guy, then have one with a roofer, then have one with an electrician, then you have one with somebody who's selling a product, so then you have somebody with somebody. I mean, it's unbelievable how many different meetings you see over and over and over in one day. I mean, staffing companies, it's incredible. So what questions do you have about the dysfunctions that you see on a daily basis with many small business owners who are, to their credit, working hard, but they're not getting ahead?
Yeah, well, the first thing that came to mind when you mentioned that was dealing with their staff, or the people on their staff, just managing, you know, your people, HR. A lot of times, you know, when we are working with a client, we may know, you know, this team player that you've talked about, you know, they're hindering things. And that can be for a variety of different reasons. It could be their attitude. It could be their obstinate. They could downright be stealing, you know, just doing anything that's not helpful, but watching them struggle with either, you know, holding that person accountable or letting them go. You know, that's something that's painful to watch, you know, when we're saying you're going to have to deal with this situation, this individual. And a lot of times it can start wrecking the team. You know, I don't know what your thoughts are about that, but I know that's something that comes up over and over. Sometimes it's family members or sometimes it's just people that they really love. They've been with me for so long.
Let's start with some biblical. Well, let's go non-biblical for 500. Boop, okay. Boop, and then we'll go biblical and then we'll work back into the.
Okay.
So here's an example. If you go shopping, I don't know where you go, Shreed. I do run into you occasionally at Sprouts.
Sprouts, yeah.
I go to Sprouts.
Yes.
Why do you go there?
Well, I love their whole philosophy. I love that it's affordable. I love that it's healthy. I love the options there. I like it.
I'll tell you why I go there.
Why do you go?
I go for the mojo that is in the place. I go there because they have people that are smiling.
They do.
They are nice people. They have Jimmy over there in the meat department off the 101st Memorial. If you know Jimmy, give him a high five. That dude brings, every Jimmy. Time I see him, he says, "What's going on, Clay?" Unbelievable.
Oh, nice.
They had Michaela back in the day working there. I liked Michaela so much, I hired Michaela.
We love her.
But you go in there, and they also have that upbeat music going.
Yeah.
They got that.
It's clean in there. It's clean.
So I walked in the other day, and I walk in, it's bump, 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 bump. And I'm going, what? Is this Bob Marley? Could you be loved?
Love it.
Oh, yeah. It makes me want to buy more meat. Could you be loved? Bump, bump, bump. And then the guy says, hey, what's going on? How can I help you? And I'm just thinking, man, this is paradise.
Yeah.
I'm a business nerd, but I love business. So I love it. The atmosphere is great. Customer service is great.
It is.
Now, I'm going to tell you a place that wasn't so great.
What?
I went in the other day to a place that I'm not going to name. I'm not going to name the place.
Okay.
I'm just going to say that we've all been there once. Mm. Mm. You go in there, no one's there to help you.
Yeah.
No one knows what's going on. Everyone's on break. You say, hey, could you help me find the produce? I'm on break.
Mm.
Hey, could you help me? I just work here, buddy. I don't know. I'm in electronics. That
I feel
kind of
like
thing.
That there's feet draggers there, too. Are they walking around dragging their feet?
Unbelievable. Yeah. Yeah. It's ridiculous. And they got this whole self-checkout thing they're trying to push you to over there.
Yeah.
And anyway, I go there, and I went there to buy a TV. And anyway, long story short, the experience was not good. It almost wasn't worth the money I saved. Mm-hmm. It was just awful.
Yeah.
So what happens is that I just don't go back. And a lot of us don't go back. That's why Starbucks does well. That's why Quick Trip does well. Because we want to go to a place where there's great customer service and a good experience. That's sort of the non-biblical thing. Now, the second thing is the Bible, though, says in Proverbs 10:4 that God blesses the hand of the diligent. He blesses the hands of the diligent. It also says he punishes the slackard. So somebody who's not working hard is going to lose. And so what happens is if you own a business, I'm not saying you have to play God or pretend to be God, but I am saying that you running a business and punishing your customers with terrible customer service because you don't want to fire somebody is the single most selfish and stupid thing you could do. And because you're not being diligent and punting idiots, the customer will fire you. And so Sam Walton, you know, this is back in the day, the old school Sam Walton, you know, this is back in the day when Walmart used to be known for their customer service.
Yeah.
He said the customer can fire everyone from the CEO on down to the chairman of the board simply by spending their money somewhere else.
Yeah.
So concept number one, you've got to have a great customer service experience or customers will go somewhere else. Two, when you discover that somebody's not getting it done, you have to hold your team accountable. And if you hold someone accountable and they refuse to do their job, you want to fire them in sort of a private way. You want to just get them out of your office, but you do just want to get it done. You want to knock it out. But Steve Jobs would tell you, here's a notable quotable from Steve Jobs. He says, you have to be a yardstick of quality. Some people aren't used to an environment where excellence is expected. So you're going to discover most people haven't ever seen excellence. So you want to educate them. You want to make sure that they, step one, do they know what to do? Step two, if they do, you want to make sure that you're holding them accountable. And three, if they won't do it, you got to fire them. Now, if somebody is being what I would call nefarious, this is one of my favorite words.
Yeah.
I love the word nefarious because nefarious is, there's no better way to describe the word nefarious. But nefarious is where somebody is intentionally doing a subversive activity.
They're evil.
Trying to do acts that go against what the boss has done. I've seen this in small ways where I've told someone to do something and they just passively aggressively didn't do the thing. If that is the case, Jack Welch would give you this little tip. And by the way, this is a feel-good tip. When you hear this tip, you will feel good. You will feel, it's like a colon cleansing. It's like you've taken a huge colon cleanse, and we don't want to talk about colon cleansing. This is an adult show. We don't talk about things like that, but I do. So what you want to do is this is like the colon cleansing of business here. So Jack Welch says, public hangings are teaching moments. Yeah. Every company has to do it. A teaching moment is worth 1,000 CEO speeches. CEOs can talk and blab each day about culture, but the employees all know who the jerks are. They could name the jerks for you. It's just cultural. People just don't want to do it. Sometimes you got to fire when it's required. And we come back, Thrive Nation. We're going to teach you everything you need to know to grow your business. Stay tuned. ThriveTimeShow.com. Hey, hey, hey. Hey, hey, whoa, hey, wow. You looking at me? Hey, you looking at me? I'm looking at you. Hey, Thrive Nation, welcome back to the Thrive Time Show on your radio. My name is Clay Clark. I am the former SBA Entrepreneur of the Year. And although I may not be looking at you right now, I am thinking about you. This is what I do. This is my whole passion. You email in your questions to info@thrive15.com. Again, you email those questions into info@thrive15.com. You text us at 918-851-6920. That's 918-851-6920. You come to our in-person workshops. You ask questions. You go to thrive15.com. You ask questions up there. And all I do is I think about, professionally speaking, all I think about is how I can help you get to where you need to go with your business. Now, I can make that claim. Sharita has seen me do it. That's why I wanted to have Sharita on today's show, because we're talking about business coaching and this obsession with helping you achieve success. Sharita has seen me do it, and she's actually a business coach.
Yeah.
And so she's actually known me since college. Mm-hmm. Now that I'm 36, that's 18 years ago. But she gets a chance to be the fly on the wall a lot of times to watch other businesses that are really struggling. And we just talked about, you know, firing people and why that can be so tough for people. And I would just say it as a capstone thought, if you don't fire people, the customers will fire you. And if you don't prune a tree, tree's going to look weird. So you got to make some cuts sometimes. So that's unfortunately the real talk about the business. But Sharita, what are other dysfunctions or other pushback areas, other predictable things where you see business owners just not able to gain traction before they have some real accountability, some business coaching, and some real mentorship?
Yeah, another area is time management and scheduling, getting your schedule organized. That's a huge area. And I know just from years of knowing you and watching you, Vanessa always says this about you. You're so myopically focused, and it's so true. You have your time, just your time management is just off the charts. But I've seen some clients, you know, really struggle with reining in their schedule, their commitments, and just really commanding their time. You know, how do you speak to that?
Okay, well, there's a couple things. One is, because I'm intentional about where I spend my time, I can have really authentic conversations with people that I really love and care about outside of work. Mm-hmm. If I didn't do that, I would never leave work. You know. So as an example, we had a guy the other day that made some really, really bad life choices. Mm-hmm. And we'll just say, thou shalt not download certain things on thy work computer. I don't know if Moses and God talked about that. It might have been like the 11th commandment.
Yeah.
We had a person in our office the other day there's a program called Slack. And Slack is a program where you could go and you basically can write back and forth to other employees. And they started writing really horrible things about me because I dared to hold them accountable to not downloading illegal things on said computers. Mm. And so, long story short, it was time to punt. It was time to go. I tried to be tactful. Guy wouldn't do it. So I had to, he wouldn't move on. He wouldn't catch the hint, as in, like, don't do this again. If you do it again, you're fired. As in, hey, you just did it again. I want you to go ahead and move on, find a new job. And he couldn't quite grasp it. So I had to do a public hanging, which is, again, Jack Welch says, a public hanging is a teaching moment. Every company has to do it. A teaching moment is worth 1,000 CEO speeches. CEOs can talk and blab each day about culture, but the employees all know who the jerks are. They could name the jerks for you. It's just cultural. People just don't want to do it. So I had to do the Jack Welch move. Jack Welch, the former CEO of GE, who grew the company by 4,000%. Well, then other people want to talk about it. They want to talk about, well, did you hear what happened? Did you see what happened? Did you see that? Did you hear what he said? Did you hear what she said about what he said? I can't believe that you did that. And I'm done. I'm in my car. I'm almost all the way home where they're still talking. I'm home. I'm talking to my wife. I'm chasing my wife around. I'm holding a bunny in my hand. I'm physically holding a bunny. We have a bunny.
He's cute. They're cute.
We had this one bunny named Oreo.
Yes.
It was definitely a girl.
Adorable.
We got another bunny I thought was a dude. Mm. Kind of a transgender, sort of a Bruce Jenner confusion thing here. And so I named him Carl. Well, come to find out, Carl's a lady.
Carla.
Yeah, but we still call him Carl because we're sick freaks. Yeah. And so I'm holding Carl, you know, and it's just ecstasy when Carl's next to me and I'm just there having that bunny love. Hey, got that bunny love. And I'm sometimes, you know, it's just something awesome about the bunny. I've got the chickens going on. I got the pinion wood burning and they're still talking about it. I turn my phone off. They're still talking about it. I get to work the next day. I check my text messages. Messages had been sent. In excess of a dozen messages had been sent in the dozen hours past the event. They're still at the office talking about 8 o'clock at night.
Wow.
One of our members of our team said, hey man, I left, and they were still talking about it. Now, because I'm pretty rigid on how I spend my time, I could spend that time with my wife, with my kids. And when O'Neill brought by that Jamaican jerk chicken?
Yes, yes, yes.
Did you help make that or did he do it all himself?
I helped a little bit.
What did you do? What was your role? What were you doing?
I helped because we grilled it and then we finished it in the oven. So I helped kind of transport meat, you know, from the grill.
You grilled it first?
We grilled it first and got that good char and that good, you know.
Where are you getting the supplies? Where are you getting that flavor from?
We'll have to give you the secret recipe off the air. Yeah, it's O'Neill's little masterpiece.
I'll tell you what.
I passed the seasoning. I'm his sous chef, you know.
I'm just saying that Jamaican jerk chicken was good and I'm still talking about it. When I get done with work, people are like, how was your day? And I'm going, I had this Jamaican jerk chicken 4 months ago. Yeah. It was so good. People gonna say, don't you have anywhere to go? Don't you have anything to do? No.
No.
No, I don't. Actually, I just want to talk about that. I mean, I spent the entire Sunday planting trees.
Oh, yes. You love your trees. Vanessa told me you guys have been planting.
Well, as Dr. Z and I were talking, what we're going to do is we're going to try to transplant a large tree.
Love it.
Z says he wants this tree, because we're building a wall around our property.
Yeah.
Z said that he wants the tree to be so big that it could serve as a wall.
So, I love it.
So he wants to get like a forklift or something and bring this thing over and dig the biggest hole in the history of the planet. I mean, he wants to plant a massive tree. And that's what you do when you have time freedom. You talk about Jamaican jerk chicken for 4 hours.
Yeah.
You talk about planting trees. I'm at Atwood's asking the guy at Atwood's every question possible about grilling, you know?
Yeah.
And they got to be thinking, don't you have somewhere to go?
Yeah.
Don't you have anywhere to do? You have something to do? No, I don't. Why? Because I have time freedom. That's the whole thing. You've got to be rigid. So time management is definitely something we teach you. And we actually teach you the time management system that our Thrive15.com mentor, Lee Cockrell, will teach you. So if you go up to Thrive15.com and you subscribe to the world's most affordable business school, it's only $1 for the first month. It's $1 for the first month.
It's a no-brainer. You got to do it.
You go up there. It's $1. You sign up there. And Lee Cockrell, he used to manage Walt Disney World Resorts and the 40,000 employees. Could you imagine what it would be like to manage 40,000 people? Some of you are crying right now. I can't even imagine. I don't want, I'm managing 4 people. I would want to shit myself. No. Calm down. You don't want to. He actually enjoyed it. He was good at it. That's why Disney had over 1 million visitors a week. I mean, if you're managing 4 employees and seeing 100 customers a week, imagine what it would be like to manage 1 million people. Well, if you're going to do that, you had better be great at time management. Now, Sharita, what are some other predictable dysfunctions that you have seen?
Okay, so some other things have to do with leads, calling your leads. And I know there's a bestseller out there that SteveCurrington.com and Marshall have written
called Call Your Leads. Call Your Leads, and it's called Call Your Leads. When we come back, we're going to teach you the importance of how to call your leads, of why to call your leads, of when to call your leads, what percentage of people call their leads, the best way to track them, sort them, to stay organized. Because once you get those leads, once you've been doing some marketing, you've absolutely got to call those leads. Yeah, we used to ball like that. All right, Thrive Nation, welcome back into the Thrivetime Show on your radio. My name is Clay Clark. I'm the former DJ Clay. Now I'm all grown up. I've started a DJ Connection, and from there I moved to starting a bunch of other businesses. Epic Photography, Elephant in the Room, Thrive15.com, the Make Your Life Epic PR Consulting Firm, blah, 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 blah. This show is not about me. This show is about you. And so Inside the Box That Rocks typically is where we broadcast. But today, oh no, we are off campus. We're broadcasting from the Man Cave, where we're always learning, earning, and burning. Inside the Man Cave, I have brought in a woman. What? What? Why would you? What, you brought a woman inside the Man Cave? I did it because I wanted to bring some balance. I wanted to bring some insight. I wanted to bring some wisdom. And so I brought in Mrs. Sherita Bent. She's a lifetime friend, in my opinion, because I've known her for longer than I haven't known her.
You know,
since age 18, now I'm closer to 37 than 36. I've known this lady. She was a cheerleader back in the day with my wife. Yeah. They worked together at their first couple jobs out of college. She's worked together with me and mother when I had DJ Connection, now with Thrive and Make Your Life Epic. And she is just a dynamic human. And she has the pleasure of sitting in and the business, a lot of the meetings that I'm actually leading, as well as coaching her own clients. Mm-hmm. She sees Dr. Z and I interact. I mean, she's able to watch all this firsthand. And Sherita, before we went to the break, you had a question about calling leads. It's kind of a typical dysfunction that we see as a business coach. Can you kind of tee that up again?
Yeah, definitely. Just we get to a point where maybe we have helped you, get your search engine, you're optimized, you're getting a ton of leads, and we have to have the conversation multiple times, with some clients about, you've got to call your leads. It always circles back to that. So I just wanted to kind of tee that up to you, because I know sometimes that's a struggle for people to understand why you've got to call your leads. We can't get around that. You've got to call them.
All right, I'm going to make a list of all the things you need to do, and with the amount of time we have today, I can't get into all the detail, but one is you must absolutely every single day print out your leads. That's step one. Step two, organize your leads. I mean, keep them organized. All your hot leads, all your new leads, put them in the right pile, right? And then you must call, text, and email every single one of your leads a minimum of 3 times a day. Because right now what's happening is most people don't answer the phone if they don't recognize the number.
True.
And as an example, my father, unfortunately, he passed away here recently from ALS, Lou Gehrig's disease, and Dad, we miss you. But my dad was going through all these things, and he switched over to a new phone carrier. So when he switched over to a new phone carrier, as he's trying to kind of get rid of his expenses because he knows he's leaving the planet soon, he's trying to switch to a less expensive phone carrier. He's trying to cancel this, cancel that, do this. Doing the mature things needed as you're facing death. Just how horrible would that be? I mean, you're calling your phone carrier saying, hey, I want to switch. They say, why? Because I'll be dead soon. I mean, that's just, Dad, I mean, that was, thank you for being the man and doing that. But the thing is that my dad, when he switched phone carriers, a lot of the phone numbers didn't get transferred. So people would call him, trying to get a hold of him, and he's not answering his phone, because he doesn't recognize what the phone number is, right? Yeah. So a lot of people don't recognize the phone number because they don't know the number, the number's not saved, whatever the situation is. There's other people that just straight up don't answer the phone ever.
True.
There's other people that only respond to text, You'll be in a meeting with them and they just respond to every text. And they're all trying to be all sneaky, all sly, acting like they're not responding. They'll be up in church. They'll be in church.
I've seen it.
And they're
seen
going,
it.
The pastor's going, everybody, if you'll turn with me to the Bible app, you're able to, and they're poof, poof, poof. They're getting text messages left and right. They're planning dinner.
They're on Facebook. I've seen that.
They're on Facebook. I mean, come on. So the thing is that one, a lot of people only respond to text. Some people only respond to calls. Some people only respond to emails. Some people don't answer voicemails. We can go on and on, but you need to call, text, and email every lead at least 3 times a day if you want to get paid. Now, Sherita, off air, you were just asking me another brilliant business coaching question about the process that we lead clients through, the proven path, and some of the typical dysfunctions that you see, and just some of your observations. And I'd love it if you could ask the question again so the Thrive community can benefit from what you were talking about.
Yeah, so I was thinking about the journey for both you and Z, with starting maybe your first business, and how maybe, you're in there hustling, you're being diligent, you're doing it by yourself, perhaps, at first. You build a team eventually. You go through the ups, the downs, you're working hard. You have this grit, this drive, this tenacity. But it was really tough because you're trying to establish that first business. But then once you get all those systems set up, you have those processes down, and your business is now running like a well-oiled machine, and it is like generating a profit flow. Well, once you and Z get down and you're starting your second, your third, your fifth, your tenth, you guys both have so many businesses. What is the difference when you're starting that first business, you know, in the beginning with the hustle and the grit and learning by the school of hard knocks, but then maybe when you're starting that 10th business or that.
Yeah, well, what we do is we go into industries where we don't have to create a product. Mm-hmm. I mean, Thrive15.com is unique because it's actually an altruistic thing for us. We built it to help mentor millionaires, to help mentor people to become millionaires, to mentor millions of people. That's why we built it, is to help you. And so it's almost like building a church. You know, we built it because so many people asked us if they could pick our brain for coffee, if we could teach them how to do it. And we just didn't have time. And I know he's not a jerk. I probably am. But we were going, hey, man, we got to find a way that we should probably help people, right? I mean, right?
Yeah.
And so that's a little different because that's creating a whole new industry. And I wouldn't do that if I were you, Thrivers, unless you have long money.
Mm-hmm.
Long money meaning that you're okay with not making a profit for like 5 years.
Yeah.
You know, 10 years. You know, SpaceX is obviously an Elon Musk company. PayPal, Tesla. Elon Musk hadn't made money. He didn't make money for 10 years. From 2003 to 2013, he didn't make a dollar at Tesla. That's kind of that innovative, long industry game changing. But I'm talking about the industries that Z and I go into. It would be like optometry, auto auctions, photography, haircuts for dudes, banking, medical supply companies, PR, marketing companies. You know, we're not reinventing the wheel here. I mean, these are already existing niches. There aren't people running around Tulsa going, well, I tell you what, I'm trying to figure out a way to cut my own hair. And they're going, well, maybe you should go to what's that word? Well, maybe you should go to, I don't know. I know what it is. We'll call it haircuts. Oh, that's a great idea. I wish there was a place in Tulsa that cut hair. Well, there's no places like it. If we could find one, we would definitely go there. I mean, we're going into an established industry where there's already people getting their hair cut. The people of Tulsa aren't running around, as a general rule, with mullets, running around wondering what to do with their hair. I mean, there's already options out there. We just wanted to provide a better option. So now we already have the team. We already have the graphic designers, the photographers, the videographers, the sales scripts, the hiring packets, the firing packets, the legal documents, we already have everything. So it's really easy for us to go into a niche and dominate, and it'll be really easy for you to go into the niche and dominate too, because we know the proven path. I mean, it's not really that complicated. So I guess I would say, Sharita, when we first started, I mean, both of us didn't know what we were doing. We're running through the fog of, he was 16 years ahead. I mean, he's 52, I'm 36. He's just running through the fog of hope and ambition and hoping he can figure it out along the way, running through the landmine of entrepreneurship, just blowing up, making mistakes everywhere. And then eventually we learned that we could learn from mentors and not mistakes. He went ahead of me, so his path was harder than mine. And my path was a lot easier as a result of him mentoring me as opposed to me running through those mistakes. So hopefully that answers the questions. It's very easy now to dominate in an established industry.
Yeah, that's great.
You know, and I would just say as an example, one of our clients right now we're working with is La Mode Cleaners. And if you've never been to La Mode Cleaners, what are you doing? Right? I mean, you could be going to Spiffy's. These are good people. You could be going to really anybody, but why would you do that? Because you need to be going to La Mode.
Yeah, they won't lose your clothes. They do not lose your clothes over there.
Let me tell you about something about La Mode. These people are so fresh and so clean.
Yes.
Now, here's the deal about La Mode. They are in a proven industry.
Mm-hmm.
They reached out to us to help them with their marketing. It's not rocket science. And because we have a non-compete, we're not working with their competitor. And we're helping them grow their business. And it's easy. It's turnkey. It's happening. They have a proven product, a proven system. And if that's you, you have a product, you have a proven product, a proven system, a proven market, a proven niche, and you just need to grow that thing quickly to create that time freedom, you have four options you can take today, four action items you can take. One, go to ThriveTimeShow.com and subscribe to our podcast. It just takes you a second, and you'll never miss a radio broadcast. Maybe you missed an earlier part of today's show. Go up there, subscribe at ThriveTimeShow.com. It's free. Two, go to Thrive15.com, the world's best business school, the most affordable business school, and it is almost free. It's a dollar for the first month. Three, go to ThriveTimeShow.com and sign up for our next in-person workshops. These are 2 days. They're 15 hours of power. And during these 2-day interactive workshops, we're going to answer every business question that you could possibly have. And you don't want to take my word for it. I am trying to sell you something that benefits you. But don't be masked. Don't be deceived by my passion. Go up there and read the reviews. Check it out. Do the research yourself. And fourth, if you want that one-on-one, honest, candid business coaching, if you want to know the proven path, go to ThriveTimeShow.com and book your assessment for Thrive Time one-on-one business coaching. As always, thanks for tuning in. And until we see you next time, three, two, one, boom! All right, JT, so hypothetically, in your mind, what is the purpose of having a business?
To get you to your goals. So it's a vehicle to get you to your destination. Whoa.
And would you need profits to get there? I mean, when you have a business that's successful, in your expert opinion, would you need profits to get you to your goals?
Yeah, because if you have a $15 million business, but you have $15 million of expenses, it's kind of pointless.
Holy crap.
All right, so the question I would have here for you, if you could take, like, I don't know, 10 minutes or less, and see if you could save $3,000 a year by reducing your credit card fees, would you do it?
Yes, absolutely.
Holy crap.
Why would somebody out there who's listening right now, who has a sane mind, why would they not go to thrivetimeshow.com/credit-card, thrivetimeshow.com/credit-card, to schedule a 10-minute consultation to see if they could reduce their credit card fees by at least $3,000 a year?
Why would they not do it?
Yeah, why would they not do it?
Maybe because they didn't understand how you said the website.
This tree is a symbol of the spirit of the Griswold family Christmas.
No, that's clear. Okay, so that could be true. So I encourage everybody to check out thrivetimeshow.com/credit-card, thrivetimeshow.com/credit-card. What would be another reason why someone would not be willing to take 10 minutes to compare rates to see if they could save $3,000 or more on credit card fees?
Maybe they think it is a waste of time and that it won't. It's not possible.
If there's somebody out there that's making more than $3,000 every 10 minutes, and they're like, nah, that's not worth my time.
Hello. We getting that money. We getting that money.
There's probably someone out there.
Okay.
They would think that.
Well, I'll just tell you, folks, if you're out there today and you're making less than $3,000 per 10 minutes, I would highly recommend that you go to thrivetimeshow.com/credit-card because you can compare rates, you can save money. And, you know, the big goal, in my opinion, of building a business is to create time freedom and financial freedom. And in order to do that, you have to maximize your profits.
Holy crap.
Now, one way to maximize your profits is to increase your revenue. Another way to do it is to decrease your expenses.
It's a profit deal. It takes the pressure off.
JT, is there any other reason why somebody would not be willing to take 10 minutes to compare rates to see if they could save a total of $3,000 a year on average?
I am at a loss and I cannot think of any other.
Shampoo is better. I go on first and clean the hair. Conditioner is better. I leave the hair silky and smooth. Oh, really, fool? Really? Stop looking at me, Swan.
Well, let me tell you a good story here real quick here. I actually, years ago, compared rates with this company here called IPS. It's Integrated Payment Services. And I scheduled a consultation. I don't know that I was skeptical. I just thought, whatever, I'll take 10 minutes. I'll compare rates.
I can't tell. You can tell me I'm a doctor. No, I mean, I'm just not sure. Or can't you take a guess? Well, not for another 2 hours. You can't take a guess for another 2 hours?
And in my particular case, I save over $20,000 a year.
Holy crap.
Wow.
Which is, groceries when my wife goes to the organic stores.
Find everything you need today?
Yeah.
Great, okay.
Yeah. Oh, God. No.
Everything okay, ma'am?
It's just that you've only scanned a few items and it's already $60. I'm so scared.
Okay, I'm a trained professional, ma'am. I've scanned a lot of groceries. I need you to stay with me.
It's just that my in-laws are in town and they want a charcuterie board.
Well, this isn't gonna be easy, so I need you to be brave, all right? What's your name?
Patricia.
Patricia, all right. I need you to take a deep breath. We're about to do the cheese.
You know, that's the difference between eating organic and not organic. So because my wife eats organic,
I had to take the 10 minutes needed to compare rates to save the $20,000 a year on credit card fees just for one of my companies.
One question, what's the brand name of the clock?
The brand name of the clock, Rod. Do
brand
we have
name
it?
Of the clock. It's an elegant from Ridgeway. It's from Ridgeway.
Let's buy.
Buy the clock.
And sell the fireplace.
So I encourage everybody out there, go to thrivetimeshow.com/credit-card. You schedule a free consultation, request information. A member of our team will call you. They'll schedule a free consultation. It should take you 10 minutes or less. And they're going to compare rates and see if they can't save you more than $3,000 a year off of your credit card processing.
You were hoping what?
I wouldn't owe you money at the
end
of the day.
No, you don't owe us money.
Because at the end of the day, the goal of a business is to create time freedom and financial freedom. In order to do that, you need to create additional profits.
Is up 411% over last year. We are Jared and Jennifer Johnson. We own Platinum Pest and Lawn and are located in Owosso, Oklahoma. And we have been working with Thrive for business coaching for almost a year now.
Yeah. So what we want to do is we want to share some wins with you guys that we've had by working with Thrive. First of all, we're on the top page of Google now. Okay. I just want to let you know what type of accomplishment this is. Our competition, Orkin, Terminix, they're both $1.3 billion companies. They both have 2,000 to 3,000 pages of content attached to their website. So to basically go from virtually non-existent on Google to up on the top page is really saying something. But that's come by being diligent to the systems that Thrive has, by being consistent and diligent on doing podcasts and staying on top of those podcasts to really help with getting up on with their listing and ranking there with Google.
And also, we've been trying to get Google reviews, you know, asking our customers for reviews. And now we're the highest rated and most reviewed pest and lawn company in the Tulsa area. And that's really helped with our conversion rate. And the number of new customers that we've had is up 411% over last year.
Wait, say that again. How much are we up?
411%.
Okay. So 411% we're up with our new customers. Amazing.
Right. So not only do we have more customers calling in, we're able to close those deals at a much higher rate than we were before. Right now, our closing rate is about 85%, and that's largely due to, first of all, like our Google reviews that we've gotten. People really see that our customers are happy, but also we have a script that we follow. And so when customers call in, they get all the information that they need. That script has been refined time and time again. It wasn't a one and done deal. It was a system that we followed with Thrive in the refining process, and that has obviously the 411% shows that system works.
Yeah. So here's a big one for you. So last week alone, our booking percentage was 91%. We actually booked more deals, more new customers last year than we did the first 5 months. Or I'm sorry, we booked more deals last week than we did the first 5 months of last year from before we worked with Thrive. So again, we booked more deals last week than the first 5 months of last year. And it's incredible. But the reason why we have that success is by implementing the systems that Thrive has taught us and helped us out with.
Some of those systems that we've implemented are group interviews. That way we've really been able to come up with a really great team. We've created and implemented checklists. That way everything gets done and it gets done right. It creates accountability. We're able to make sure that everything gets done properly, both out in the field and also in our office. And also doing the podcast, like Jared had mentioned, that has really, really contributed to our success. But that, like I said, the diligence and consistency in doing those in that system has really, really been a big blessing in our lives. And also, you know, it's really shown that we've gotten the success from following those systems. Yeah.
So before working with Thrive, we were basically stuck. Really no new growth with our business. And we're in a rut and
The last 3 years, our customer base had pretty much stayed the same. We weren't shrinking, but we weren't really growing either.
Yeah. And so we didn't really know where to go, what to do, how to get out of this rut that we're in. But Thrive helped us with that. You know, they implemented those systems, that they taught us those systems. They taught us the knowledge that we needed in order to succeed. Now it's been a grind. Absolutely. It's been a grind this last year. But we're getting those fruits from that hard work and the diligent effort that we're able to put into it. So again, we were in a rut. Thrive helped us get out of that rut. And if you're thinking about working with Thrive, quit thinking about it and just do it. Do the action, and you'll get the results. It will take hard work and discipline, but that's what it's going to take in order to really succeed. So we just want to give a big shout out to Thrive, a big thank you out there to Thrive. We wouldn't be where we're at now without their help.
Hi, I'm Dr. Mark Moore. I'm a pediatric dentist. Through our new digital marketing plan, we have seen a marked increase in the number of new patients that we're seeing every month, year over year. 1 month, for example, we went from 110 new patients the previous year to over 180 new patients in the same month. And overall, our average is running about 40 to 42% increase month over month, year over year. The group of people required to implement our new digital marketing plan is immense, starting with a business coach, videographers, photographers, web designers. Back when I graduated dental school in 1985, nobody advertised. The only marketing that was ethically allowed in everybody's eyes was mouth-to-mouth marketing. By choosing to use the services, you're choosing to use a proven turnkey marketing and coaching system that will grow your practice and get you the results that you're looking for. I went to the University of Oklahoma College of Dentistry, graduated in 1983, and then I did my pediatric dental residency at Baylor College of Dentistry from 1983 to 1985.
Hello, my name is Charles Kolaw with Kolaw Fitness. Today I want to tell you a little bit about Clay Clark and how I know Clay Clark. Clay Clark has been my business coach since 2017. He's helped us grow from 2 locations to now 6 locations. We're planning to do 7 locations in 7 years and then franchise. And Clay has done a great job of helping us navigate anything that has to do with like running the business, building the systems, the checklists, the workflows, the audits, how to navigate lease agreements, how to buy property, how to work with brokers and builders. This guy is just amazing. He's this kind of guy has worked in every single industry. He's written books with like Lee Cockrell, head of Disney, with the 40,000 cast members. He's friends with like Mike Lindell. He does Reawaken America tours, where he does these tours all across the country where 10,000 or more people show up to some of these tours. On the day-to-day, he does anywhere from about 160 companies. He's at the top. He has a team of business coaches, videographers, and graphic designers and web developers, and they run 160 companies every single week. So think of this guy with a team of business coaches running 160 companies. So in the weekly, he's running 160 companies. Every 6 to 8 weeks, he's doing Reawaken America tours. Every 6 to 8 weeks, he's also doing business conferences where 200 people show up, and he teaches people a 13-step proven system that he's done and worked with billionaires, helping them grow their companies. I've seen guys from startups go from startup to being multimillionaires, teaching people how to get time freedom and financial freedom through the system. Critical thinking, document creation, organizing everything in their head to building it into a franchisable, scalable business. Like one of his businesses has like 500 franchises. That's just one of the companies or brands that he works with. So amazing guy, Elon Musk kind of like smart guy. He kind of comes off sometimes as socially awkward, but he's so brilliant and he's taught me so much. When I say that, like Clay is like, he doesn't care what people think when you're talking to him. He cares about where you're going in your life and where he can get you to go. And that's what I like the most about him. He's like a good coach. A coach isn't just making you feel good all the time. A coach is actually helping you get to the best you. And Clay has been an amazing business coach. Through the course of that, we became friends. I was really most impressed with him is when I was shadowing him one time. We went into a business deal and listened to it. I got to shadow and listen to it. And when we walked out, I knew that he could make millions on the deal. And they were super excited about working with him. And he told me, he's like, I'm not going to touch it. I'm going to turn it down, because he knew it was going to harm the common good of people in the long run. And the guy's integrity just really wowed me. It brought tears to my eyes to see that this guy, his highest desire was to do what's right. And just an amazing man. So anyways, impacted me a lot. He's helped navigate. Anytime I've gotten nervous or worried about how to run the company or, navigating competition and an economy that's like, I remember we got closed down for 3 months. He helped us navigate on how to stay open, how to get back open, how to just survive through all the COVID shutdowns, lockdowns.
I'm Rachel with Tip Top Canine, and we just want to give a huge thank you to Clay and Vanessa Clark.
Hey guys, I'm Ryan with Tip Top Canine. Just want to say a big thank you to Thrive 15. Thank you to Make Your Life Epic. We love you guys, we appreciate you, and really just appreciate how far you've taken us.
This is our old house, right? This is where we used to live 2 years ago. This is our old neighborhood. See? It's nice, right?
So this is my old van and our old school marketing, and this is our old team. And by team, I mean it's me and another guy.
This is our new house with our new neighborhood.
This is our new van with our new marketing. And this is our new team. We went from 4 to 14, and I took this beautiful photo. We worked with several different business coaches in the past, and they were all about helping Ryan sell better and just teaching sales, which is awesome, but Ryan is a really great salesman, so we didn't need that. We needed somebody to help us get everything that was in his head out into systems, into manuals and scripts, and actually build a team. So now that we have systems in place, we've gone from 1 to 10 locations in only a year.
In October 2016, we grossed $13,000 for the whole month. Right now, it's 2018, the month of October. It's only the 22nd. We've already grossed a little over $50,000 for the whole month, and we still have time to go. We're just thankful for you, thankful for Thrive and your mentorship, and we're really thankful that you guys have helped us to grow a business that we run now instead of the business running us. Just thank you, thank you, thank you, times a thousand.
The Thrivetime Show, two-day interactive business workshops, are the highest and most reviewed business workshops on the planet.
You can learn the proven 13-point business systems that Dr. Zellner and I have used over and over to start and grow successful companies. I mean, we get into the specific steps on what you need to do to optimize your website. We're going to teach you how to fix your conversion rate. We're going to teach you how to do a social media marketing campaign that works. How do you raise capital? How do you get a small business loan? We teach you everything you need to know here during a two-day, 15-hour workshop. It's all here for you. You work every day in your business, but for 2 days you can escape and work on your business and build these proven systems so now you can have a successful company that will produce both the time freedom and the financial freedom that you deserve. You're going to leave energized, motivated, but you're also going to leave empowered. The reason why I've built these workshops is because as an entrepreneur, I always wish that I had this. And because there wasn't anything like this, I would go to these motivational seminars, no money down, real estate, Ponzi scheme, get motivated seminars, and they would never teach me anything. It was like you went there and you paid for the big chocolate Easter bunny, but inside of it, it was a hollow nothingness. And I wanted the knowledge, and they're like, oh, but we'll teach you the knowledge after our next workshop. And the great thing is we have nothing to upsell. At every workshop, we teach you what you need to know. There's no one in the back of the room trying to sell you some next big, get-rich-quick, walk-on-hot-coals product. It's literally, we teach you the brass tacks, the specific stuff that you need to know to learn how to start and grow a business. And I encourage you to not believe what I'm saying, and I want you to Google the Z66 auto auction. I want you to Google elephant in the room. Look at Robert Zellner and Associates. Look them up and say, are they successful because they're geniuses? Or are they successful because they have a proven system? When you do that research, you will discover that the same systems that we use in our own business can be used in your business. Come to Tulsa, book a ticket, and I guarantee you it's going to be the best business workshop ever. And we'll even give you your money back if you don't love it. We've built this facility for you, and we're excited to see you.
If we go back 8 years ago, think about the number of clients you had back then versus the number of clients you have now. As a percentage, what has been the growth over the past 8 years, do you think? We got to inspire somebody out there who just doesn't have the time to listen to their calls.
Okay, so Clay, it's like I would go up and down from about $10,000 a month up to about $40,000, but it was up and down roller coaster. And so now We've got it to where we're in excess of 100 clients.
That's awesome.
And so I would have anywhere from 5 clients to 20 clients on my own with networking, but I had no control over it. I didn't. Without the systems, you're gonna be victimized by your own business.
For somebody out there who struggles with math, if you let's say that your average number of clients was 30 and you go to 100, as a percentage, what is that?
I have doubled every year since working with you. So I've doubled in clients. I've doubled in revenue every year. It's 100% growth every year I've worked with. Now, so I'm looking. We've been good friends 7-8 years, and I've got doubled 5 times.
Which is just incredible. I mean, the first time you do it, that's one thing. But when you do it repeatedly,
yeah.
I mean, that's unbelievable.
We're working our blessed assurance off this year to double. We're planning on doubling again. We're incorporating some new things in there to really help us do it. But we are going to double again this year. I started coaching, but it would go up and down, Clay. That's when I came to you, as I was going up and down, and I wanted to go up and up instead of up and down. And so that's when it needed a system. So creating a system is you have nailed down specific steps that you're going to take no matter how you feel, no matter the results. You lean into them and you do them regardless of what's happening. You lean into them and it will give you X number of leads. You follow up with those leads, turns into sales. Well, I tell you, you know, it's if you don't have a script and you don't have a system, then every day is a whole new creation. You're creating a lot of energy just to figure out what are you going to do.
Right.
And the best executives, Peter Drucker is a father of modern management. He said, the most effective executives make one decision a year. What you do is you make a decision, what is your system? And then you work like the Dickens to make sure you follow that system. And so that's really what it's all about. So with a script here, we have a brand new gal that just came in working for us. She nailed down the script, and
yep.
She's been nailing down appointments. Usually we try to get one appointment for every 100 calls. We make 200 to 300 calls a day per rep.
Right.
And she's been nailing down 5 and 8 appointments a day.
Somebody out there is having a hard time.
On that script.
So she's making how many calls a day?
She's making between 200 and 300 calls a day.
Whoa. And our relationship is weird in that we do, if someone were to buy an Apple computer today,
yeah,
and or let's say you bought a personal computer, a PC, the computer is made by, let's say, Dell. But then the software in the computer would be Microsoft, let's say, or Adobe or whatever that is. Mm-hmm. So I basically make the systems. And you're like the computer, and I'm like the software. It's kind of how I would describe our relationship.
Yeah.
Tim, I want to ask you this. You and I reconnected, I think it was in the year 2000 and, what was it, maybe 2010? Is that right? 2011 maybe? Or no, maybe further down the road. Maybe 2013?
2012.
Okay, so 2012. And at that time, I was 5 years removed from the DJ business. And you were how many years removed from tax and accounting software?
It was about 10, 11 years.
We met, how did we re-meet? What was the first interaction? There was some interaction where you and I first connected. I just remember that somehow you and I went to Hideaway Pizza. But do you remember when we first reconnected?
Yeah. Well, we had that speaking thing that...
It was. So yeah. It was Victory Christian Center. I was speaking there.
My name is Robert Redmond. I actually first met Clay almost 3 years ago to the day. I don't know if he remembers it or not. But I wasn't working with him at the time. I asked to see him and just ask him some questions to help, you know, direct my life, to get some mentorship. But I've been working with Clay for now just over a year. The role I play here is a business coach, business consultant. I work with different businesses implementing best practice processes and systems that I have learned here by working with Clay. And the experience working here has, to put it real plainly, has been just life-changing. I have not only learned new things and have gained new knowledge, but I have gained a whole new mindset that I believe wherever I end up will serve me well throughout the rest of my life. Since working with Clay, I have learned so much. I mean, I would like to say almost everything about business in terms of the different categories. I haven't learned it all. But I've learned all about marketing. I've learned about advertising. I've learned about branding. I've learned how to create a sales process for organizations in any industry. I've learned how to sell. I've learned how to create repeatable systems and processes and hold people accountable. You know, how to hire people. It's almost like every aspect of a business you can learn, I have learned a lot in those different categories. And then again, the mindset that I've gained here has been huge. You know, working here, you can't be a mediocre person. You are a call to a higher standard of excellence. And then as you're called to that standard here, you begin to see those outcomes in every area of your life, that standard of excellence that you want to implement no matter what you're involved in. I would like to describe the other people that work with Clay are people that are going somewhere with their life. Marshall in the group interview talks about how you know, the best fits for this organization are the people that are goal-oriented. So they're on their own trajectory, and we're on our own trajectory. And the best fits are those people where there can be a mutually beneficial relationship, that as we pursue our goals and we help the business pursue those goals, the business helps us pursue our goals as well. And so I'd say people that are driven, people that want to make something of their lives, people that are goal-oriented, they're focused, and they're committed to overcoming any adversity that may come their way. Clay's passion for helping business owners grow their businesses is unique in that I don't know if there's anyone else's that can be as passionate. You know, whenever a business starts working with Clay, it's almost as like Clay is running that business in the sense that he has something at stake. You know, he's just serving them. They're one of his clients, but it's as if he is actively involved in the business. Whenever they have a win, he's posting it all over his social media. He's shouting it across the room here at Thrive. You know, he's sending people encouraging messages. He can kind of be that life coach and business coach in terms of being that a motivator and that champion for people's businesses. It's again unique because there's no one else I've seen get so excited about and passionate about other people's businesses. The kind of people that wouldn't like working with Clay are people that are satisfied with mediocrity, people that want to get through life by just doing enough, by just getting by, people who are not looking to develop themselves, people who are not coachable, people who think that they know it all and they're unwilling to change. I would say those are the type of people. And in short, anyone that's content with mediocrity would not like working with Clay. So if you're meeting Clay for the first time, the advice I'd give you is definitely come ready to take tons of notes. Every time Clay speaks, he gives you a wealth of knowledge that you don't want to miss. I remember the first time that I met Clay, I literally carried a notebook with me all around. I was looking at this notebook the other day, actually. I carried a notebook with me all around, and I just took tons of notes. I filled the entire notebook in about 3 or 4 months just from being around Clay, following him, and learning from him. And then I would say, come coachable. Be open to learning something new. Be open to challenging yourself. Be open to learning and adjusting parts about you that need to be adjusted.